pledge allegiance, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. We have a roll call of three members starting with Steve Catterer.
Nick Romano.
Stephanie Keel.
Victor Joe.
Alex Campbell.
Sean Morgan.
Tom Gallagher.
John Data.
Larry Gay.
Rick Pierce.
Julie Dagliardi.
Jameson Souza.
Mark Cutoff.
Thank you. First up, we have review approved minutes of the April 3rd, 2012 meeting, which were distributed with your agenda. Entertain a motion to approve those minutes.
So moved.
Second.
Motion is second. Any discussion? Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
I abstain.
You abstain? Please make a note of that.
I will.
Okay.
Everybody, you know.
Next up, we have AI3 report on project status and next steps. And what I wanted to do tonight is, as I noted in the email that went out, the information was distributed, is that this is kind of a chance for us to catch up on where we are and what the next steps are in the process, kind of between the two crunch periods, I guess, of the design and the bid process. So for both AI3 and SCANS, we're going to ask them to kind of go over the status, where we are, what's coming up, what we need to be worried about next. So, Troy?
Sure. The documents are on the street. Since our last meeting, April 27th, the documents were completed. They were uploaded to our FTP site, the printers for Skanska. The week of the next week, the following week, the week of April 30th through May 4th, bidders submitted all the binders, MSBA binders that we put together with the documentation was submitted, submitted to the MSBA, submitted to Skanska. These are the year documents here, and drawings and specifications also were submitted that week. The documents were available for bidders on the 2nd, Wednesday the 2nd. There are about 123 plan holders at the moment, not including consultants and Skanska, us. And it was a very, very successful delivery of the documents in the end. Very smooth working in the tail end with Skanska and the committee members of the school department. It was a very smooth transition, smooth delivery of the documents. The next step actually is tomorrow, which is a pre-bid conference for the contractors. And that's at 3:00 tomorrow. That basically allows any bidder, or anybody for that matter, to come and ask questions, take observations of the existing building, the site prior to submitting the filed sub-bid or general bid in the next several weeks. We also have, as part of the preparation for construction, we provided Skanska with the documentation related to the structural schedule for structural inspections and testing. That includes steel testing, inspection of welds, soil testing, compaction testing. This is done by an independent third party, which probably Skanska will get into during their discussion. The next item is related to the building permit. We put together the construction control affidavits signed by all of the consultants as well as our office for compliance with the building code, the 8th edition of the building code regarding controlled observations during the process that we'd be out there in accordance to the requirements of the state building code. Also along with that is two stamped sets of drawings and specifications, full-size drawings and specifications that are delivered to the Inspection Services Department. The next, one of the next items that we'll be talking about, it won't be next meeting or the meeting after that, but it will be early in the construction process, is the color palette and our presentation of the color palette to the building committee. And I'm going to ask Brian to go through just a brief explanation of what that process is and how we go through selection and receive approval from the sales rep.
The general contractor and filed sub-bid contractors will submit shop drawings to us shortly after they come on board regarding the products that they intend to use on a project. We will then review the product literature that's associated with those shop drawings. That includes data sheets, performance data, and physical characteristics of all the products to ensure that they're compliant with all the standards that we have listed in the specification binder. Upon review and approval of those shop drawings, we will request color sample information, whether that be paint samples or materials of that product, with all of the options for the colors. We will then assemble a color palette for the project, which will include toilet partitions and other materials, metal lockers, the gymnasium divider curtains, wall mats, fixed audience seating, the fabric that's associated with those seats, countertops, which would be a plastic laminate and epoxy resin, as well as fabric wrapped acoustic panels and other materials on the project. In addition to that color palette, we will also provide rendered elevations of a number of the design spaces inside the building, whether that be a typical classroom, typical corridor, the auditorium, lecture hall, art classrooms, the library, the athletic room, and a number of other spaces throughout the building. Upon approval of that color palette and the renderings that are provided to the committee, our office will then generate detailed interior finish drawings, which will be issued to the contractors for installation. And those include the location, or they provide the location and color of all the paint finishes throughout the building. And they will also provide all the flooring patterns and colors for resilient tile, resilient base, rubber flooring, paver tile, carpeting, porcelain paver tile, and epoxy painted floors as well. And that is the process that we'll go through for color selection.
That's usually, once the contractor's on board, it will probably be 2 months, month to 2 months into that process before he starts to submit the data relative to the finishes. And at that point, we're able to compile all that information and put together the color chart. So it's likely that you will see that process start in somewhere in August of this year. Once the project is up and running, the GC is on board, he's moving forward. There are two, any questions regarding the color selection? I just have two additional comments aside from the colors. Okay.
At least one on that. What is the amount of time when you talk about bringing this stuff to the committee? Is it like, are we going to have a couple of meetings to look at that stuff, or, you know, what's the time when we get to that point?
Yeah, we'll have. If we're meeting every 2 weeks during the construction process, sometimes the meetings during the construction process go out monthly. But in any case, we'll have at least a couple of meetings that will present the proposed color palette and field any questions, comments, thoughts regarding the selection, and then make adjustments, come back, and I'll present again with the adjustments and go through that process. Yeah, this certainly isn't a one and done type situation. Unfortunately, the the collective group has been able to see Norwood and see Whitman Hansen and see some of the finishes that are provided there. Don't necessarily need to select exactly the same color, but we're going to have a nice classic professional feel to the overall selection when we bring it to the committee. Anything, any other questions on the colors?
Is this a committee just like consensus in terms of the colors we're going with, or how is that decision made in terms of what fabrics are selected ultimately?
Yeah, we're going to put together a proposed palette, and I can tell you through experience, if it is a complete committee charrette decision, et cetera, it's going to take a long time to get through the color process. So I would not recommend that every single entity has or group has a say in what happens with the color palette. Again, we're gonna select a pretty classical, sophisticated palette of colors. It's just not blindly selected. There's research behind the selection of the colors, whether it's in the various spaces, the classrooms, or the larger cafeteria, or the larger spaces relative to mood, relative to social and psychological reactions. So there's a significant amount of backup reasons why certain colors are selected. So when we go through that process of presenting it, we'll talk about the reasons why we selected certain colors for certain spaces and finishes for other spaces. It should be a pretty streamlined process, but I would caution against having tons of groups in the district commenting on the color palette.
Yeah.
Hey, Rich.
Sounds like a full year.
Would you have you worked with subcommittees like design subcommittees in the past? Is that what's pretty effective? A pretty effective way of presenting and getting feedback and then developing some of the palettes. So maybe at some point we could think about establishing a design subcommittee here. Or
yeah, and it, yeah, no, that's
finishes.
We've done that, and yeah, we've also presented to the committee and fielded comments, and come back to the committee, and as a sort of a final pass, as yes, this is the acceptable way to go. If the group is hung up on one particular material or one particular color, it's a scenario where we can go through and accept the vast majority of the presentation, and if there's one that's hung up, then we can present that again, but not hold up the entire process and palette related to one condition. I can't think of a scenario that's happened before, but certainly not something we rule out.
Actually, if I could just add, there is a time sensitivity with some of these decisions because we're in this middle review process and contractors require decisions made so that way they can order the materials and move forward. But I think in this case, they typically supply them with a lot of the information well in advance of when they actually need to procure their materials. So we'll get there. That's all fun stuff.
It's always fun.
This is more fun.
Just two more very quick comments. I mentioned the streamlined process and the efficiency in which the project went out to bid and delivered. And I don't think I've said this with this group in the past, but I got to tell you that going through the design process with the members of the building committee, members of the subcommittees, the presentation committees early on, it has been extremely a great process. Very professional. Everybody has been extremely professional, from this group all the way down to the staff. The presentations very well organized. The information that you folks put together collectively was by far one of the better sets of presentations from the very beginning that we've seen throughout the entire process. And that sometimes you go through the process and think, wow, that was very quick. It was painless and for all intents and purposes, and it was professional and well organized, and nothing is said. But I think kudos to everybody in this committee. We've worked with many, many committees in the past, and very proud to say that everybody was positive and informative and pushed the project forward and did not pull the project back at any point in time during the process. So I thank you guys for that process, or that input and that mentality and group effort, the team effort. And I think we talked about the team effort moving into construction as an extremely important topic. And this group is set up right now for success for the construction of this project. And we hope that the GC that's inserted within this process also has the same team mentality, because that's what's going to ultimately take this entire group collectively with the GC through the construction process to make this one successful project as it has been thus far. So I just wanted to mention that to everybody. Second is, and I don't think Guy Borges is here, but I just wanted to highlight the effort that Guy put in over the last several months, because sometimes you have individual committee members who insert themselves into the design process and have an agenda and have something to prove or have something that they are pushing. And Guy Borges was just the opposite. He came in with one, in our opinion, one sole reason, is that to be the committee's eyes and ears, to make the process better and to provide input where he has a lot of knowledge, it's thus far it's been a pleasure to work with him. My engineers have said the same thing, and I think he did an excellent job on behalf of the committee, just taking a look at the drawings and making sure that it's customized to the way the both towns have either proceeded with the HVAC or the building systems in the past, or what they're envisioning in the future, and becoming providing input to our engineers and to us regarding that that area or scope of work. So I thank him from our side for helping improve that process and not having an agenda, but just being there for the committee's sake, for your best interest. And that's refreshing to see. That's it.
I think that deserves a round of applause.
Does anyone have any questions of Troy or AI3 regarding where we are? I kind of asked him before the meeting a week or so ago if he could just bring us a video of the new school, how it's going to look when it's done, because that's what we all want to see. But unfortunately, we're just not there. We can't do that. But so we're still going on the dream and the faith, you know. So
the best video you're going to see is when the 24-hour camera is replayed at the end of the construction.
At the end, yeah.
You can see the building.
Any other
any questions for AI three before we let him off the hook? Mr. Pierce.
Where is the pre-bid conference, the actual spot?
At the high school.
But where?
Cafeteria.
Cafeteria.
Anyone else? Okay. Thank you, Troy. Ryan? And moving on, Skanska report on open items and next steps.
Great, thank you. Well, we have a few updates and just some discussion items that Mike has already, I think, sent around, so everyone has our list. Just a few updates on the contract, the pre-qualification status. I'm sure, as it's already been mentioned, we're out to bid. We did have to deal with a couple of pre-qualification issues. We did have that expedited building committee meeting last week. And for those who were there, again, thank you for accommodating us on that, because we did have to deal with a reevaluation of a general contractor, actually, and that's all been squared away. The contractor has since picked up documents and is in the process of bidding the project. There hasn't been any request to extend our bid schedule as a result of them losing a few days in the process. We've also addressed any of the questions that have come up from other contractors and subcontractors who are not pre-qualified by sending them whatever information they're asking for. Once we've completed the pre-qual process and things have been accepted, essentially anything is, mostly everything is available as part of a public records request. So if they're looking for their score, if they're looking for how they were evaluated, if they're looking for other contractor scores, we've been accommodating with that. And I think some of that is just I want to see how they compare to others. Sometimes they are potentially building up a protest if they feel that they were scored unfairly. I think the process that we engaged in here with AI3 and with the help of Steve and Bob Anktel, we established a very objective, it was an objective, it was also a systematic way of evaluating contractors, so that way it would be difficult for a contractor to come back and challenge the process. They could challenge it if it was done in an arbitrary way. They could challenge it if it was done in a way that could be capricious or fraudulent, any kind of effort like that. But we, as a pre-qual committee, worked very hard and diligently to make sure that it was a very pretty obvious process. So I think even if someone was to try to challenge it now, I don't think they'd go very far. I think it was a very consistent manner. So that's just a quick update. We are out to bid. The next page of the document shows you the current plan holder list, and highlighted are the list of the contractors that have been pre-qualified that have actually picked up documents. So you'll see, obviously, all of the general contractors, masonry, a few other categories are like that. There's a few here that we're still, you know, the acoustical tile, we pre-qualified three, but only two so far have picked up. Cheviot hasn't picked up at all, and they actually submitted on metal windows as well as the acoustical tile. So we may be reaching out to some of these contractors on the roofing and flashing. We did reach out to Gibson. They had done a big project for us out in Attleboro, and we were just wondering why they hadn't picked up yet. But there's really, other than acoustical tile and elevators, we're not really overly concerned with the number of trades, the number of contractors have picked up. It's pretty typical. I'm sure that, and the other thing is, this is who's on register. This doesn't mean that they haven't been getting their information through other means. They have like Project Dog and some of these other agencies that are out there that some of these contractors have an account with, so they get a lot of this information. So they may not be on the register that the plan holders are actually logging. So it doesn't mean that they wouldn't end up submitting a bid in the end. It's just, this is who's been on register. This is who has been logged into the system as procuring documents. I don't know if anybody has any questions about that before I move on to the next item, but it looks pretty good. I mean, we're pretty satisfied. I don't know how you guys feel, but it looks pretty good. The bid addendum, I don't know if Troy, if you get into the bid addendum, but essentially there is an addendum. When the construction documents go out, the plans and specifications, there's always opportunity to clarify questions that either have been raised by the contractors during the bidding process or even just through their own quality control effort of just cleaning up some of the items that might need to be clarified. There was addendum number one was issued on May 10th. And I'm sure there'll be a few other ones. Usually after the pre-bid conference tomorrow, a few questions may come up by the contractors that may need to get clarified. In my opinion, the more questions that are asked, obviously, it shows that they're engaged in the review of the documents, the better. Anytime that we can address a question during the bid time, just reduces that potential, you know, the potential of that actually becoming a change order down the line. So I think it's a good thing. Hopefully we're getting a lot of questions. I know there's been a few contractors. So I don't know if there's anything that you wanted to identify as part of what were the main items in the bid addendum that went out the other day. I noticed that it was some ceiling tile type clarifications and some clarifications of scope in the auditorium. I don't know if there was anything really more than that, but yeah, nothing major, right?
No, that was pretty much it, except for the there was some
electrical
items in there that that we collectively were going through and inserted within the
addendum. What do you typically issue for a denim on a project like this? 3, maybe 4?
Depends on the the situation. There may be addendums, there may be 7 or 8 addendums, right, but they may
small
be one-page addendums.
Yeah.
There may be 4. It's really hard to tell. It depends on when the questions are submitted to us, when the most appropriate time is to answer a question. As an example, we may issue an addendum, you know, 4 or 5 days before the filed sub-bids, and then there's a question that comes up that it would be better to answer than not, so we'll issue another one pager.
Sure.
So it really depends on the situation.
And all of this information is available through the Repro Graphics company. I don't know if that information has been shared, but anyone can just basically set up an account and they can see what's been issued.
And you can see, even if you go on, it's ATJ Plan Room, ATJ Andrew T. Johnson, planroom.com. And if you hit on the upper left-hand corner, Public Projects tab, it'll show all the public projects that are listed by ATJ. And Somerset Berkley is one of those. And you can look through all the drawings and all the issued specifications. If you want to request a set of drawings by hard copy or via or electronically, you will have to register. You can just browse through them if you want to, without having to register.
So in addition to the addendum that's identified on there, so is the list of plan holders. So there's actually little tabs. Once you go into the Somerset Berkley project, you can just click on it and see who's actually picked up. That's where we were able to. Last time I went on there, I printed out the latest list of the contractors, and I compared it to our pre-qual list to see who's picked up. So, all right. And if I could just skip over that next bullet, because I'd like to spend a little bit more time discussing that. I know that, Troy, you had mentioned on-site testing agency. This is something that we will be in the process of procuring. We did receive some information from AI3's consultants in terms of how we need to develop the scope of the work. In the project budget right now, there's $50,000 that's been earmarked for this type of work. Sounds like it could be about right. It also just depends on how much is actually going on out there. So. We will begin the process of identifying some of the consultants in the area that specialize in this, and bring that back to the committee in the future in terms of who we've identified, who we've sent the RFP out to, and get some prices on that. This is a company that would be billed through us as a reimbursable. It's part of our contract, and there'll be other subcontracts like that, but this is probably the biggest one when it comes to part of our responsibilities of having an agency out there to test and inspect. As Troy mentioned, concrete, soil, steel. There may be some other things related more to geotech, which I think we're going to be possibly getting a proposal from AI3 to have the geotech be able to perform some on-site services as a as-needed basis is usually how that is. If they encounter some unsuitable material out there, we need somebody to come out there that specializes in geotech to make sure that, you know, what needs to come out, what needs to go back in order to make sure the building will be structurally sound is. We do have a couple of areas on site that are like that, so we'll have to see how that comes out. So, and actually, if I'm not mistaken, in their original contract proposal, they actually identified some of these services below the line as not to exceed budgets, I think, for services if they're needed. So that's one of them. On-site air monitoring is another one. We're actually doing the abatement of the building. You'll own the abatement of the hazardous material through the contractor's contract, but you'll also need somebody there doing air testing monitoring and just making sure everything's been done properly. Give it a clean bill before it actually can come down. So we'll be talking about that later on. And just some quick updates on where we are with the budget. Basically, you can see the numbers right there. This is taking it through April. You'll start to see these numbers change dramatically when the contractor's on board, because they're going to take up a big chunk of that. And when the contractor is on board, we'll be providing you with a little bit more than just, I mean, we'll still do this summary just so that way it's a little easier to follow, but there'll also be a bigger spreadsheet that we'll prepare each month that basically shows exactly how that's being processed through the month. But essentially, there's been a total of $2.2 million approved through the month of March, and there's two invoices for April, one from us, one from AI3. And once those are approved, the total invoices through April will amount to $2,547,186, leaving a balance of a little over $80 million. So, and like I said, the contract is going to take a big chunk of that once they're on board. Hopefully not too big. Hopefully the bids come in well. And I don't know if Troy shared this with everyone, but they just recently received bids on a new middle school, Hingham Middle School. And the bids came in a little more than $2.2 million under budget. So that's a good sign.
That is a good sign. Don't take that as...
No. We're not predicting anything here, but yeah, you know, it's just good.
What percentage of the budget was that?
Well, and the thing is, you know, I was looking at the list of the contractors who actually bid on that project, and 95% of them are the same contractors who've been pre-qualified on this project, if not all of them. And what typically happens is that the general contractor who didn't get that job may be very aggressively pursuing this job. It doesn't mean that the one that did get it won't aggressively pursue this one as well, because I've been told that they really want this job. So I think we're going to have some pretty good competition here. So let's hope to see some of the same results, Troy. Keep our fingers crossed.
Is the low bidder on that project public information?
Yes.
Yep. Who was it?
Bray Builders.
And I think you had bids from Agostini, J&J, who else?
CTA and Bray.
Oh, CTA also? Okay, yeah. So you have similar contractors. TLT actually submitted on that one as well. That's the fifth one. They weren't pre-qualified here.
There was Agostini, Bacon, Bray, CTA, H.V. Collins, and TLT.
The other good thing is that a lot of the numbers were tight, which is always another good sign. You know, when you see tight numbers, tight bids, it means good documents. It goes without saying. That just means that, you know, high quality documents, properly coordinated, will result in better bids and tighter bids. So, all right.
Dan, just before, you were citing Hingham?
Hingham Middle School. Yeah, Hingham Middle School. And that was a total, I don't know, how did the files of bids? Did the files of bids also come in under budget?
Yes.
They did. So the file set bid trades also came in on the budget, and the general bids also came in on the budget.
Okay, good.
Well, that is good. That's good news. And continuing on down to the project schedule summary, I do want to note that I forgot to put one word in on June 7th. I put note date change. I should say note proposed date change. This isn't something that's been discussed.
That was you about this.
Yeah. Well, yes. So I forgot to put the word proposed in there. But essentially, we are now at our building committee meeting on the 15th. As mentioned, we have a pre-bid conference tomorrow at 3 p.m. Located at the high school cafeteria. And I'm sure from there we'll take a tour of the school, quick tour through the school, and more of a tour on site. Hopefully we'll have a good turnout of contractors and they can ask some questions. The FALSA bids are still due on May 30th at 3 p.m. at the regional school district office. We plan on being there to provide assistance when these 80-plus bids show up on that day. We weren't expecting to put that strain completely on the central office, but typically we need one place. That's the place for everything to be submitted. We'll be there, Mike and I, and I'm sure our folks from ASU will be there, but we'll be there to receive the bids, working with Rick's staff over there, stamping things in, logging them in, making sure that they're all set to go. Once they're all in, we'll be starting the bid opening process. So I guess what we do need to do is pick a place in the school to open up the bids.
Yeah.
I don't know if that was identified in the spec book, but other than that, of where they're due
right
there. So we can deal with that on that day. Just tell people where to have the opening. All we need is a classroom or anywhere.
Right here
is perfect. So. And that one is a little more time consuming because, like I said, we're receiving all the files of bid trades, and we could receive 70, 80 bids. We break them all down by category, open up each one, and read them aloud. It takes a little while to go through everything. The general contractor bids are a little easier. Hopefully we receive all four. That usually doesn't take as long. And again, if they're all coming here. We'll talk later about a proposed change to our next building committee meeting. We also have, in the future, we have a meeting scheduled for June 20th, and that's to approve June 7th, if it does change to June 7th, will be to approve the FALSA bid results that have come in. And hopefully we're not dealing with any kind of bid protest, but if we are, we'll be presenting that as well. We'll be talking about that. June 13th, we received the general contractor's bid. On June 20th, if all goes well, we're making the recommendation for award. You folks award the contract, and we're moving forward, which is a good thing. And I don't know if, Julie, if you're going to talk a little bit later on about groundbreaking ceremonies and stuff like that. So, and July 2nd is the official start date for the construction activities. So that is it. Does anybody have any questions on anything that I've just mentioned on this before we go on to the next topic?
Typically for opening of the file bids, sub bids, and the general contractor bids, is that something that it's a meeting where the committee is present, or it just happens with the staff take care of it, and then we would hear of that at our next meeting?
Anybody can be at the bid opening.
Okay.
Yeah, but it's not necessarily a meeting. We're receiving bids and then opening bids. By statute, we have to open up the bids publicly.
Okay.
So anyone can be here to listen through that process. What would happen is we'll probably have our computer set up. We're going to already have a bid tab ready to go. And as the results are coming in, we're plugging that information in. We'll have it as a non-official bid results because we still have to go through everything. Even though we've pre-qualified the contractors, there could still be mistakes made in their bid itself that would require them to be disqualified. So there is a review process. So when we're receiving them on that day, it's really unofficial bid results. You can get an idea that, you know, this is who's the low apparent. We'll say the apparent low bidder until we actually have gone through the process to make sure that there's nothing wrong with any of the bids. Trust me, I've seen it where, you know, you see a low bidder, everybody thinks that's the low bidder, and one, another challenging sub will look at and go, well, they didn't do this, and they didn't do this, and you have a protest in your hands the next day, and you're starting to, you know, deal with that process.
Would you expect that if they're opened on the 30th, by the 7th, you'd have kind of that all checked out so that we would see as a committee a more final document noting those final?
That's our intention. Yeah, if everything comes in fine and we're not really dealing with a lot of issues, if we're not expecting any, it's not going to take us all that long to make sure that we go through. They have to have, there's certain required documentation that they have to include in their bid. Even though they were pre-qualified, they still have to follow the next step in the bidding process. So we'll be working with AI3. Team of us will be going through everything to make sure that everything's complete before it gets presented to the building committee. The thing is, if we, you know, even if we make our presentation on that day, on the 30th, and we say, here's the bid tab, here are the results, you know, we still have time to go through this. If we find something else, the owner always has the right to reject a bid if we discover something later on. But the idea is that we take care of it beforehand, because this is the same list that's going to go to the general contractors. This is a list that would be issued as an addendum to the general contractor, so they know who the trades are and their numbers, because they carry those numbers in their bid. So
once that file sub-bid list is finalized, that's what goes to the general contractor.
So yeah, I don't, I mean, that gives us basically almost a week, I think, to, we receive them on a Wednesday, we have a building committee meeting. I think in this case, well, yes, that was the Wednesday or Thursday that of that meeting, whether it's the 7th or it's the 8th. But yeah, no, that gives us plenty of time. We'll be dedicating some a fair amount of time to go through everything and make sure it's ready. And the same thing with the general contractors. You know, obviously there's only a handful of those, but we still have to make sure that everything's squared away. So, any other questions on this?
After this, after July 2nd, will you be issuing a construction schedule to follow?
A construction schedule?
Like, in the beginning, you had a schedule that said that take us through 2014 with all the phases on it. Is there a schedule that will be able to follow along with the general contractor?
Oh, sure. Yeah. And we can do that before then, but actually it's better to have the contractor on board. Once they're on board, we can see if they're going to adjust the phasing at all, and then we could share that with the committee. But yeah, each month, what we plan on doing is showing the progress of the schedule and of the budget. So
the budget.
Yeah,
okay.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. So those are some of the two key things. I mean, we don't want to see this project lag at all in terms of the contractor schedule. Contractor's fully responsible for the schedule, but we'll be reporting on that. And I think we have a good list of contractors, so should we provide it?
Why don't we, before you go further, why don't we see if we can nail down that date? Because I was going to have it in the head now.
Yes. Yeah.
Now, the when we last met, I think the 5th and the 6th were conflict. Well, the 5th was a conflict. And now the 6th is. The 7th is a Thursday. It's typically a school committee night.
Is
Somerset
that a school committee?
It's a Somerset school committee.
Does it like preclude the group? It just means that there'll be individuals, including myself, who won't be.
Right.
And in this room.
And yeah, there's a few of us.
What time is the school committee?
How long that meeting would take place?
The only thing on that agenda will be this, will be the fossil bids.
And typically?
Just basically reporting the results.
Yeah.
Could you meet at 5:30?
Yeah, we could.
Is an hour good?
An hour.
We could meet in a different site within the building in the event it ran over.
Sure.
Oh, yeah, we could definitely do that.
Yeah,
that'll
be fine. I mean, we're not anticipating any issues with the bids, but you just never know. But
right.
I think when we're here at that point, it's really, you'll have a bid tab, you see all the bid results, all the numbers, and it's really just, you know, accepting the results of the bid. That's essentially what it is.
Yeah, does that work for folks if we do June 7th at 5:30?
Seven on Thursday.
Sounds like good summer dialing time. I didn't say that.
Either day.
Is there anything else that night? That's graduation week.
The day before graduation.
That the
honors
National
night.
Society?
Yep, we have a conflict. All right, I mean, three events.
Oh, but not 5:30, I guess.
Yes, it is. It's moved up.
Yes,
it was moved up.
Okay.
5:30 to accommodate the Somerset School Committee.
No.
What's up?
Okay. No, I don't. I have to say that it's probably not a good time for the high, for myself personally, people associated with the high school group the day before graduation. I don't have to.
No.
You need the building committee to approve. So you don't need every individual within that. So the principal and myself are at a National Honor Society or a school committee event that I think this group could still accomplish that.
Sure.
I'm not offering.
Well, it's up to you. I mean, I don't know. I mean, I don't know if it's too late to meet a week later. To approve anything, what do you think, Troy? If we were to push it
why
off,
why can't we do the sixth? Why can't we do the sixth?
Well, like everything that's going on over here, it's something that's going on with my son for graduation.
How about is Monday the 4th? I don't remember if it was Mondays.
No, that's fine.
Monday would be
fine. The document, the document's going to be released to the contractors anyway. It's not. The committee is just going to hear the results.
Yeah.
It's not. There's
so
no.
So the committee has no action.
No, there's no action.
Oh, so there's no vote. You
there's
know,
no action taken on the final subject results.
I think if people are
good, we'll do 7 to 5:30. Yeah, or even if you wanted to meet on the 4th, that works as well. So.
June 4th, the Monday.
Monday night.
It's town meeting, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, there's something every half day.
My thought is, you can have it on Thursday. School officials will already know the bid results. I mean, so we don't need to hear the bid results. We'll definitely be informed prior to. I'm just thinking, so it's just good for the building committee to hear.
The only reason why we may need some action is if we have to disqualify someone. Would you require
if there's something that
if there's something
requires,
wrong,
if there's a protest or
right.
if there's a necessary disqualification or a contractor pulls his bid for mathematical error or something
right.
like that, then depending on the scenario, the committee may need to take some action.
Other than that, if that doesn't happen, it's really just a report of the results. But that's the reason why we need a meeting just in case.
And it's better to do it sooner rather than later. Meaning I would not probably go to the next week and have the meeting at that point because your GC bids are coming in the 13th.
I'd do it the 4th or the 5th.
You
can't
do it at the
4th. Berkley Town Meeting, actually.
Well, if you didn't, if you want to believe it on the 6th, I just couldn't be here for that. So you're in the Dale. So if the 6th works better for everyone here, it's really only to accommodate my. I have a conflict that night.
Mm-hmm.
So rather than if you want to leave it on the 6th,
yeah.
I won't be here.
Yeah.
What do you think?
We're available either night.
Yeah.
Thursday would be better, but.
Wow.
Just one last night.
So you decide, really.
Personally, I'd like to have a project manager. I just think it's, it's part
well,
of all.
The 7th at 5:30 only precludes Jamal and myself from missing that event. There's 22 members. And
actually, and I did want to say that there would be another reason for us to be meeting. It's to follow up with what we're going to be talking about later tonight about
right.
project rep. So I just remembered that. So that's the other follow-up to that. So the 7th, it would be good if I was there.
Okay. 75 feet, does that work for folks? Mr. Pierce, no.
Well, I was planning on being at the Honor Society program, but I'll just have to make a judgment at the time as to where I end up, depending on whether it's going to be a routine meeting here or not, so I guess.
Our meeting could be less than 30 minutes if it's just a report and there's really not much else.
Should we have it at the high school?
Go at another room at the usual restaurant. Just to offer that.
We did that once more. We had an event. We had a meeting in the cafeteria.
Right. Yeah.
You could
do 5 o'clock in the library.
We got to be back here for
the
National Honor Society is here, no?
National Honor Society is the high school, the Somerset School Committee meeting that night is here.
Here. What time? Dr. Mosley, National Honor Society starts at 5? 5:30?
Yeah.
So 5 o'clock at the high school.
Everybody can make it to the Honor Society.
So no matter what, go into the National Honor Society if need be.
And there'd be all the time to get down there for a minute.
That's fine. Yeah.
So 5 o'clock on June 7th at the high school?
High school.
Library?
5 o'clock.
Just to confirm that. It's on the library. I'll just find out the spot. It's a 5 to 5:30 meeting.
Safe.
Well, it's just supposed to be for 5.
We can't fire.
I'm sorry.
No.
Get passed.
Okay. Well, thanks.
So what's the date and time, Mom? 5 o'clock, high school library. June 7th at 5 o'clock at the high school.
Correct. 5 o'clock.
All right. So the last item on here, if we're all set on that, was for us to talk about how we're going to handle our on-site project representation. As part of our contractual services, we're required to have somebody here full-time during all construction activities. We did send out in advance a summary of the typical responsibilities that we have as project managers during construction. That's basically a third page in. This is strictly just how it's identified in our contract. It doesn't include everything that we're responsible for. I just want you to know that. This is just how, items as it relates to the on-site project representation. And most of it was really captured in that very first bullet where, you know, we're providing somebody on site to be the eyes and ears of the building committee, of us, the architect. The architect's on site regularly. Mike and myself will be on site hopefully 2 to 3 days a week. We'd be out here full time as well if we could. But we have a person that would be out there all the time during all construction activities. Basically, a record keeper, someone who's going to be identifying everything that's going on, being the holder of the files, construction files, taking lots of pictures, and all these documents. And it's unfortunate, but that's just the way that the public construction process has been, is that you need somebody out there that's doing this. We've relied so heavily on the information that we'd have to go back 6 months to discover what, you know, if somebody is challenging, if we're, you know, questioning some workmanship issue, it's very easy to find the information and deal with it by having this information available. But the idea is to really avoid having to do that in the first place by having somebody monitoring the work. We're ultimately responsible for the oversight as project managers, but we're not the contractor. So there's clear and distinct responsibilities that we have, that the architect will have during construction, as will the contractor. And while there may appear to be overlap, there's actually clear lines between, you know, where our work ends and the contractor's work must begin in terms of like safety and scheduling. We're monitoring, we're making sure that they're on schedule, that the workmanship is in line with the documents that have been prepared, Basically, to make sure that you're getting what you paid for. And the key responsibilities is budget, quality control, and schedule. Those are our three main things. So you don't have to read all of this now, but essentially, this kind of summarizes everything that's going on. And when there is a change order, sometimes it's change orders that get processed as a time and material basis, because we can't agree on a lump sum number, let's say, if we don't believe the number that's coming in from the contractor. This person would be there monitoring and specifically signing off on the actual time and the materials that are used, so we have the real data. So it's a real important position. The reason why I'm bringing all this up, there's a couple of reasons. One is, as we're getting closer, I just want you all to understand what to expect during construction activity from our end. But the main reason is, when we were first brought on board as your OPM, we had identified, if you go down on the fourth page down, you'll see the org chart, looks like this. We had initially identified Jim Dowd as our project representative, and you can still, all the other names haven't changed. Dan Lamville, you've seen, Joe Palermo was our cost estimator, a few of these other people were really more behind the scenes when we needed them. Dale and myself have all been constant, the constant on the job, and going to remain on the project. But what happens is MSBA requires us to identify a project rep at the beginning of a job before you even know if the project's even going to go forward. Sometimes it's 6 months later, a year later, sometimes it's further out. So we're required to identify someone. We've identified someone. Unfortunately, this person is now on another project. So we started to look at how we wanted to staff the project during construction on site. Either internally, Skanska is a big company. We do have people that we try to identify for this role, but they're all, fortunate for us, we're busy, and a lot of these guys are being identified elsewhere. So on the next page, there's a block in there where we've identified a gentleman by the name of Bill Fryer. And in this package are his credentials, resume, references, as well as a referral letter that came in from the town of Swansea on a project that Bill had worked on. I personally have worked with Bill on the Bourndale Elementary School project. He was the clerk working for Turner Construction at the time. He was the project rep for Turner Construction during that 2 years over at Bourndale. It just so happened that Bill became available to us. He was actually identified to be working on a project in Fall River, Mass. I think it was the bus terminal that actually came in over budget, and then they stopped the process. So he was originally going to be unavailable. He contacted me, I want to say almost a year ago, when he found out that we had the job, to just keep him in mind if we're going to need someone. So it turns out that we do need someone, and we would like someone like Bill to be our representative as well as your representative on the project. Bill wouldn't be hired as a consultant, we would be hiring him. He'd be a Skanska, full-time Skanska employee. But we wanted to first mention to you that, there is a change from the project rep that we initially identified. The formal process is, once this gets accepted, that we identify somebody else. We just have to submit this to the MSBA at some point to let them know that there's been a change in the org chart. But we wanted to present this and answer any questions about Bill. We're not expecting a decision tonight, but we would like you to meet him at some point. And we're thinking maybe on the 7th, if you are agreeable to considering us having this substitution. So as part of, as part of this process, we need you to agree to the change in our personnel.
This Jim Dowd had all these credentials to lead the AP. I noticed that Bill Fryer doesn't have any of that. Does that make any difference?
Jim actually takes on more of a project management role these days. So those credentials, actually, those lead AP and the MCPPO stuff, is actually beneficial in that regard. Bill, on the other hand, has more of a construction background. As you can see, his resume, he initially started off as an IRS agent, so he has an accounting background, which is actually really good on projects like this as well. But you can see he has also an unrestricted license, construction supervisor's licenses. His experience is geared towards construction. Jim is a little bit more towards management right now. The job he's on in Saugus, he's managing as well as, he's not even on site, you know, 100% of the time. He's sharing that with somebody else out there, but he's unavailable for this project.
Dan, just one question. For the Bourndale Elementary School, how large of a budget was that? What was the budget for that project?
Bill gave me three packages to bring, and I didn't bring them. That project was, I should know this because it was my job, it was a smaller scale job. I think it was like on $20 million construction.
And I noticed that he's worked with two of the general contractors that would be bidding, Agostini and Great Builders.
Right. Okay. Those are the ones that are a little bit more recent, right?
Has he worked with AI3 at all?
I don't believe so.
No, we haven't.
I mean, internally, if we were to try to find somebody that matches this guy's credentials, we wouldn't find that person with his public experience, public school construction experience, and just being in the public sector experience. Skanska is a construction management company, but they do mostly private construction management. They don't do public construction. Well, they do a little bit of public construction management. But I find his credentials unmatched right now in terms of who we'd be able to identify to put out here. As far as all those other things, the MCPPL, the lead AP, you know, Mike and I are all, well, I don't know if you're lead yet.
Not lead yet.
Yeah, no. But we're both MCPPL. Mm-hmm. Huh?
Could I ask?
Fails lead and MCPPL.
Yes. The Swansea Police Station, which is the most recent one that he has a reference for, what was the scope of that project?
That was the new police station, built right on Route 6.
I looked online and it appeared that it was about a $5 million project.
I think that's a little more than that. I think it was probably a little bit more than that, but roughly around there probably. Under 10. But the other jobs, and I did, you know what, and this may not be enough, and what I'd like to do is send out some of the costs associated with some of these projects. I think the Pembroke High School and the Dennis Yarmouth High School, especially the Pembroke High School project, I think is getting a little closer. I think it was like a $50 million project, so it's a little closer. The thing with it is it still takes it's the same process in construction, it's just a longer duration. So when you're looking at cost, it's really just a matter of the scope being larger.
You look at
take a longer time.
6 years ago, it's a huge difference in cost too.
Sure.
I mean, if you built that $50 million school today, it'd probably be 75, 80 million anyway.
Well, I would like to have a better idea of the scope of the project.
Sure.
I have to say I'm a little surprised that Skanska doesn't have someone on staff to manage our project.
Well, I'm managing your project.
Well,
this is the person that we're assigning on site, and if Jim Dowd was that person, we wouldn't be having the conversation. He'd be basically being just put out here during once the contractor gets signed out here. But basically, I'm the one that you need to hold accountable for this project on the OPM side. So whether it's Bill, whether it's anybody else, he's our person that is basically just going to be located on site, doing his thing, daily monitoring, record keeping. We'll have a trailer out there. Mike and I will have a place out there. So that's not going to change. But I understand, you know, your concern about it's the switching of it. And it is interesting because, I mean, you would think that we could just pull anybody from any project and just put him here. The problem is it's the time. You know, when we were hired, it was probably, what, a year, over a year ago? It was a year ago, right. So it's hard to hold people, you know, in place to say, well, you know, you can we're just going to hold you as a placeholder for an entire year. So as a project comes up, as they do, they get reassigned to different projects, so something that we can't really avoid. But actually, the thing is, I'm the one that's recommending this guy to Skanska, and they're all over it because they haven't seen anybody with this type of experience, and that's why they want to hire him. They don't want to just hire him as a consultant. They want him on board. They want him as an employee because they see this as a real potential asset for other projects after this one. So,
Dan, if I could just ask, maybe on this subject, the way I would interpret this is you're going to be actually supervising the work of this individual.
Yes.
As part of your project.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Bill, what are you reporting? So maybe if you talk a little bit about during the construction phase, you're and Mike's involved in the process. It's not like this person, whoever it is going to be just kind of out there doing their own thing.
Yep.
So watch them.
Well, you know, that's a good point, because my responsibilities and Bill's responsibilities, or whoever would be out there as a private rep, are actually a little different. I'm not going to be outside every day taking pictures, doing record keeping, being the clearinghouse collecting all this data. We'll be on site, and just speaking for me directly right now, is I'll be on site hopefully at least 2 to 3 days a week. That's what I'm trying to schedule myself for. We're at every construction meeting. We're involved in the project resolution. If there's an issue, if there's a change order, we're basically going to be the ones, Mike and I are the ones working with AI3 to work these issues out. Bill is not really a manager, he's not working anything out. We're basically gonna rely on him for more of information, records, as opposed to having him be the one that's responsible for disputing anything or even resolving anything or working these issues out.
Dan, I noticed on his resume there's a lot of clerk of the works title, and basically that's what he's doing. He's gonna be a clerk of the works for Skanska.
Yes.
Skanska is gonna be our project manager. So basically, he's gonna watchdog the contractors and report to you guys what's going on.
Right.
And basically,
he puts together a daily report. We all get it, and this is something that we talked about, you know, having available through our website, so
yeah,
we could add for the building committee. You know, once we get to that point, all this information will be available, so that way it's there. Pictures with it would be their progress photos. Those are the types of things that this project rep will be doing. The clerk of the works is a project rep. It's just that MSBA identifies those folks now as project representatives.
Right. Is he going to organize coordination meetings and stuff like that, or is that still you and Mike's job?
He'll be involved in those, but the coordination meetings will be coordinated through AI3, through us, as well as the contractor. The contractor coordination meeting, you're talking about on site?
Yeah, on site, coordination, you know. Subcontract coordination, so you know, contracts aren't stepping on each other.
Yep.
On a daily basis.
There'll be, I think typically it's usually weekly subcontractor coordination meetings.
Right.
We'll be in that as well. You know, he's just basically a person to be involved in facilitating some of these things and being the keeper of documents, the keeper of these files.
So you'll have a coordination meeting this week, and next week you'll make sure that people are on the schedule with what
yep.
was discussed at that meeting, and then talk back to you guys. So.
And if you're PM, you're the one that's ultimately responsible anyway, huh?
Yes.
Do
you
have any authority?
I can't do this.
Any control over signing off on things, or who?
He will be, you know, when it comes to changes, let's say, like, as I mentioned, like, for timing material items, he'll also be following up on things. You know, if something got changed in the field, you know, either through a clarification or supplemental instruction out there, he'll make sure that and all of these pieces have been carried through. When it comes to typically a clerk, because I was a clerk for many years before I got into this other line of stuff that I've been doing, the clerk is one of those positions where they don't have any authority but a lot of responsibility, where they're not held accountable for certain things. We want to make sure that what they're held accountable for is really the record keeping aspect of it, not necessarily signing off and approving the contractor's work. We don't approve the contractor's work either. It's really, AI3 is the author of the documents. They're the ones that are enforcing the contract with the contractor, and we're working with them to enforce that. So Bill on occasion, or the project rep on occasion, will be asked to oversee a change order, let's say. There's something that's being done on a time material, and he'll be out there monitoring the work, signing the slips, and then those slips would get converted over to a to a change order. He's not approving anything other than just saying, yep, this plumber was here for 3 hours doing this work that's associated with this change. So that kind of stuff is what he'd be working.
And he would document that change as far as picture taking, taking pictures.
Exactly. And that's one of the things. I mean, I've worked with, you know, other project reps or other clerks in the past, and his organizational skills, you need to be extremely organized. There's so many activities that go on this project. It starts off a little slow, you know, with the site contractor, but midway through construction, you could have 80 people working in there, and he's responsible for documenting who's on site. Because the other side of all of this is that on a public records process, there's what they call the wage reports, the certified payroll reports. So he's collecting those, he's comparing that to what's actually being held up there, because it's a complicated thing, but that is something that we're verifying all the time.
What contractors are there, how much labor they have, how many journeymen, how many apprentices, how many hours are on the job, the whole nine yards.
And that's a key thing. That's a key responsibility. I found him to be extremely organized.
Same thing.
Had very good record keeping, and I don't recommend too many people in my line of work. But I have no problems recommending it for this one. And I'm not looking for an approval tonight. I think tonight it's really just to introduce the concept that whoever it was that we did initially identify is not available. We're identifying somebody else. He's not currently a Skanska employee, but we want to hire. That's actually contingent on how you guys feel.
You said you had three packets of information, presumably from three prior jobs.
Yes, just sitting on my desk at home.
Okay, so could we get those?
Yes.
I would like to, I'm not criticizing this gentleman. I don't know anything about his background, but as you indicated, it's an important position. So I think if there are letters of recommendation on other projects other than a $10 million job in Swansea, I'd feel more comfortable if we could see. I think there's more to managing a $70 million job in terms of just scope and number of employed people that are on the site and all of the rest. So I would appreciate any additional information that you could provide.
Yeah, how would you like me to do that? Because there's basically just three documents in a folder, and it's actually a bound folder that I could bring somewhere for review.
Or we can even scan
everything that's in there and send it around to everybody.
Yeah, that's probably the best way.
Okay, so that's what we'll do.
Is there any interest in checking any of the references?
Well, maybe you want more references other than the reference letter that's in here and me.
Well, there's a packet in here that says references. It's somebody from Mattapoisett School, Warrendale School, and the Swansea Police Headquarters. There's nothing in there for the Pembroke or Dennis Young.
The other schools, okay.
Was Pembroke a new school?
I'm not that familiar with
Dennis Young. I think was an addition and remodel.
I think so.
If we could have some information, I know, but I would think that Pembroke was a new school because they didn't have a high school before.
Yeah, there was Silver Lake.
So, we had some information on that and maybe a reference from that one.
Yep. So a reference on Pembroke and Dennis Yarmouth.
And then Dan Bourndale, that was a new elementary school?
Brand new elementary school, yeah. K through four, pre-K through four. And I do want to point out that, you know, we'll, during certain times of this process and this project, because, you know, it'll basically peak at a certain point and then it'll stop to, I mean, we may be staffing other people out here as well. It's just what we do. So we may have, you know, people out here during the summertime helping us out. It is a big project. We are your managers. It's who we have out there to help us make sure that we're on top of everything. So as things start to really get busy out there, we may have a couple extra people out there. We may even have an administrative assistant out there just helping us with the filing, things of that nature. So it's real important that, you know, in the end here, this is all leading to the success aspect that Troy mentioned earlier. There's so many pieces that can go wrong on a project. All these checks and balances, beginning with a tight set of documents, a good contractor, a reasonable building committee and a project manager who's basically overseeing the whole thing to make sure that everything is getting delivered when it's supposed to be getting delivered, so.
Some question.
It's a big responsibility.
Some question, are the workers on site all going to be quarried?
All, yeah. Yeah, in fact, I think there's an ID process in the specs, so every contractor out here will have an ID. I think when we, I mean, the good thing is basically they're all gonna be fenced off and they should very rarely ever be coming over onto the other side of that fence until things are starting to transition. And at that point, and that's another thing that Bill, the project rep will be making sure that, you know, people are out there wearing the hot hats, you know, following the safety procedures that have been outlined, and just in general keeping everything safe. He's also the liaison, so he'd be somebody that would be working closely with the administration there. If they had any questions, he's on site all the time. They'll have a cell phone, they'll be able to meet and talk about things. So he's gonna be a key person in terms of communication and just being available for that. So.
How about the surrounding neighbors as well? Yep. He'd be the contact for them.
Exactly, yeah. I mean, we'll be out there too, but because he's out there all the time, he'd be a good person for that to have as a point of contact. So we'll
take that up at the next meeting. You're gonna get some additional information.
I get some additional information.
Okay.
Is there anything else, any other additional information I have that we're gonna get some more references and some more information on these projects that he's identified as well, in terms of like what the scope was, whether it was a reno, what size of the project it was, and anything else related to? Okay.
All right, yeah, if anything else comes up, just send something to me and I'll make sure Dan gets it.
Yep. So. We appreciate the consideration of the change. It's not something that I think we typically like to do. MSBA is actually revamping this process a little bit because they understand. They actually are telling project managers now, just put TBD as your project rep, because nobody knows a year from now or a year and a half from now in terms of who could potentially be that person on site. They're actually telling some OPMs to just throw a few resumes in there just as a hey, it could be this person, it could be this person, it could be this person. In the end, we're ultimately responsible for providing the project management services. So whoever we put out there is representing all of us, so we wanna make sure it's the right person.
Any other questions on where we are and where we're going? I just had one, I'll go back to Troy, if you would, just because we had a lot of discussion about on-site during the building process, and I know that AI3 has, will Darren be the on-site person? Can you maybe just talk a minute about what he'll be doing, what his role is there, and how often he's going to be there?
Sure. Darren Sawyer, one of the other partners, you met Darren at the last meeting. You also met him at the interview. Part of our success is that Darren is on site, is from AI3 overseeing the construction process and the construction project. By virtue of the building code, we are required to provide on site observation, periodic on site observation. Typically results in once or twice a week. And it changes at heightened times during the process at various times when we're needed. Sometimes Darren's on site 3 or 4 times a week. Some other times he may be there once a week. It's all about the sequence and point in the process that the information is needed or he's needed out in the site. Our consultants, and he basically oversees what our consultants do, what our in-house staff does throughout the construction process, and he's the primary contact that the building committee or Skanska is contacting, same with the general contractor. Our consultants, MEP, fire protection, and structural, all the consultants have a very similar mindset when it comes to construction. They're readily available, and during various periods of the construction, one of them may be on site more than the other. As an example, at the beginning of the project, our civil and site consultants will be on site more than the MEP consultant. Structure will be they'll progress in a similar fashion as the building construction progresses. That's basically it.
Troy, who's the architect and record for this job?
I am, as the for AI3.
So technically, you're going to sign off on everything?
I signed and stamped all the drawings for the building permit sets, as required by the building code.
Same thing with occupancy and stuff too, right? As built, so you have to sign them all?
Well, Darren will go through the construction process. Darren will sign all of the change orders. Darren will sign all of the payment requisitions. He'll review all the payment requisitions because he is essentially the partner in charge during the construction. He'll go through that process. He's the one that will be closest to the project. Like myself, you've met him, he's one of the partners of the company, and he will be doing the signing of the documents during construction.
Thank you.
Anything else?
Yeah. Rich, if I could just add, I mean, one of the things that I'd like to do, because I mean, we're in the bid process right now, but before we get into the construction process, we'll provide more information as it relates to the construction procedures and sequences and some of the responsibilities as a building committee that you'll have during the construction process. We also have, there's a lot of information, there's a lot of things that go on during construction. So I have a document that's already prepared that helps understand some of the things that go on, like the RFIs, request for information, and the change order process, and what that all means and how that all relates. So we'd like to share that at a future meeting at some point, and then it's a document that you can reference in the future should something come up that you have a question on. It also outlines in general the responsibilities that we all have on this project, including the contractor. So it helps you to understand that, to be able to distinguish some of the roles and to establish the expectations that we all have, because we all have different responsibilities here to help this project become success. So I'm hoping to maybe at some point, not necessarily give a presentation, but get this out to you so you can actually have it and then talk about it if you want.
And I think at some point, and I don't know, maybe we don't need to do it too soon, but I'm thinking we need to establish some kind of a group that is going to be representing the committee when we get to that construction phase.
Yes.
On site for the weekly meetings and having the approval.
Exactly.
To work on maybe work orders, changes, or whatever it might be that are critical that might have to be addressed before a regular meeting. But we probably should talk about that maybe in the later June meeting. I don't know if that's too soon or if that's...
At some point, I think it would be good to establish that subcommittee to handle and deal with some of those
So
things.
If you have some kind of guidelines of what responsibilities or what authority they need to have, that group would need to have. So I think it's going to be something similar to what we're doing. And we have a few people that are authorized to sign some of the invoices and maybe not taking away the authority of the full building committee, but you're going to have a group of people are going to be able to stay closer to that weekly meeting, if you will.
Yes.
And make sure things are.
Yep.
Rich, I don't know if it's probably time either, but the historical documentation
mm-hmm.
piece, we're getting close to putting job trailers and I don't know if there's any photographic history that should be taken of some of the site now, maybe, before we start parking construction vehicles here and fencing stuff off. I don't know what our commitment is to the historical people, but I know we discussed, and I don't know who's actually going to end up handling that piece, but we might want to take pictures of the existing ball fields and football stadium or whatever, and the way it exists today, because... 2 months it won't exist.
Right. That wouldn't be required for the historic commission. I think that's more
just
specific
the
to the building. But some of those other things, if I know the historical society was talking about doing a something before the school changes, you know, some kind of a video and post that, so make them aware of the site stuff if they're interested.
So kind of like the present.
Right. Okay. You all set on those two pieces? All right, moving along, communications update.
The communications committee has been meeting to plan our groundbreaking, which is coming up, as Dan mentioned. One of the dates that we're looking at, we feel strongly that this is probably the best date to get it in this summer, as opposed to moving it to September would be June 29th. And I'll go through some of our plans for that. We've actually already enlisted the help of the graphic arts students in the high school to help us design a save the date card, so if you want to keep one. This will, with the committee's okay today, will be going out to a list of people, especially dignitaries, state and local officials, the MSBA. We've already, through Mike, contacted the MSBA to kind of put on their radar the date of June 29th. Because they do require it in about a month, 2 months, 2 months notice. So we've just made that. So what we're thinking of doing is June 29th at 1 o'clock in the afternoon on the front lawn of the existing Somerset High School. We're planning about an hour-long program that will have some speeches, but what we've really done with the help of Sue Brousford and Dr. Mosley is work to get involvement from the students. So there'll be a song written by the faculty, David Marshall, about the school that will be sung by Ruth there. We'll have the band play, we'll have a cheer done by the cheerleading squad. So we're expecting about an hour-long program, and then we're going to follow it with a reception in that art gallery, and it'll be kind of a sweet pastry kind of reception that we're looking to do afterwards. I think that what we're hoping to do is we're sending out a little over 100 of these. We don't think we'll get that, but we're planning on having a tent with some chairs and trying to invite as many people who play a role in this building coming together. So we'll come to you at the next meeting with some more concrete examples for what the program will be like. We're checking on some of those things. We also, as you mentioned, John, we are also, Jamie's working with Lori on recording the, I guess what's going to transpire through the construction process. Do you want to talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, it's not officially announced. We did receive a letter and a check, but it will be officially announced soon. But Bank 5, it will be donating some funds to sponsor, to buy, to purchase the necessary equipment to do a 24-hour webcam, live webcam, that will be attached to the high school. Dr. Mosley, Lori Belcher, myself, were kind of talking briefly about it prior to. We're going to have to talk to Ray Nezrak and the staff and figure out all the details, but this will be for the community that can go on the site at any time on our website, and we'll be able to view. And then we'll incorporate that into some sort of montage at the end of the whole building being built in a like a 3 minute or 4 minute kind of.
As well as that, we're gonna have a time monthly or whatever that we meet with one of you guys, take us through whatever with the hard hats on and all that stuff. So there'll be programs that'll be going on, and we'll make it also part of the news program that's gonna be on Access Television. So people will always know what's going on, either Julie or whoever wants to host it. Maybe a different person every month.
So this is a very big effort on Somerset Access to take part in this. I think it'll be a great communication piece for the communities.
So one of the things we wanted to do, Tony, that'll go on throughout the construction process, but one of the things we want to work with SATV9 is putting together a program, a 60-minute type program, that will highlight all of the work of the subcommittees that has actually led us to this point. I mean, one of the things that I think people out there feel almost like we went silent, that there wasn't that much going on. And what we'd like to do is bring to the forefront the work of the Site and Fields Committee, the Historical Committee, some of these other groups, the Technology Committee. So if over the next week, we will be contacting the chair people of those committees to try and arrange either a time where we can come and film one of your meetings or interview some of your members so that we can create kind of this backstory. And that will hopefully air prior to the groundbreaking ceremony. So it kind of leads up to that, and then we'll have the groundbreaking ceremony. And as Laurie mentioned, these kind of updates going all the way through until we actually cut the ribbon later on. So
who's sponsoring the groundbreaking? You're gonna have expenses and all that stuff.
That was my next piece. We are fortunate to have Bank 5 help us with the time release camera. But we estimated, we are getting some donated pieces, but we are estimating a project budget of about $1,000, which we thought was pretty reasonable to get this done. And the question was, should that come out of the, in checking with our project managers, it can either come out of the school district or it can come out of the budget or the building. We thought it was a fairly nominal fee, and so I just wanted to kind of bring that to the committee and just for a discussion and thought of how it should, because we're going to start getting, I have to pay for postage. So that's going to come up pretty soon.
Well, I guess the question is really between the regional school district and the building that they might be working in. The regional school district controls both budgets. So it would seem like it's probably not budgeted in the regional school budget. And, it's probably, I don't know where it's more appropriate to come from, but we don't have a budget line for this in there. What would it come out of?
It would just come out of like an onus contingency. Obviously, it's not reimbursable,
yeah.
But it is. You do have money in that budget to pay for things like that. So
right.
It's up to you how you want to spend it. I mean, it'll get submitted because everything gets submitted through the MSBA. It just
right.
gets pushed back as not a reimbursable expense,
right.
But you have the budget for it.
So we thought that if we could go through that route of the owner's contingency, that all the costs could be processed and just kept within that.
Within the budget itself, because it's
right.
related to this
it
budget.
Is related.
That's right.
Yeah.
To this project, then.
Yeah, right.
Is $1,000 enough? Before I make not to exceed motion, I want to make sure it's going to come here.
We could always come back to you.
I make a motion that we allow the Communications Committee a budget of not to exceed $1,000 to prepare for groundbreaking ceremony.
Second.
Discussion.
We did look at having a tent because of June 29th for two reasons. The sun being very hot, we thought also it would provide some visual for that. We're going to rent some chairs. In looking at, we contacted L&E and they provided us with a discounted price for that. Wherever possible, I used to work in fundraising, so we're going to try to get as much donated or at a discount to try to put on an event. I think that would really celebrate this event. But that's why we're looking to get the tent for that. Yeah?
I just have a question for Julie. As you recall, Treasurer Grossman was looking, he probably
yes,
will be
yes.
here. And will there be any Somerset ice cream
yes.
available, I guess?
Yes, we're looking to get Somerset ice cream
yeah.
available. That's why the thought was to have kind of an ice cream social
reception.
Oh,
that sounds good. Yeah,
that's good.
But
yeah.
we're kind of working that in because
we are working on
cranberry bog ice cream. That'll be there no matter what.
Okay.
If you go to town,
okay,
we'll
right.
have some ice cream.
We do know, though, it's June 29th
yeah.
and the high school
yeah.
is not air conditioned.
Yeah, that's
oh.
kind of.
Oh, okay.
But we absolutely will have that.
Yes, okay, good.
Yeah.
Just don't want to forget that.
Yes.
Hopefully he makes it.
I think
yeah.
it's on the schedule.
It is on the schedule.
He is free that day.
Yeah.
Executor of the board of directors for MSBA.
Yeah.
He's actually, I don't mean he said,
yeah.
wants to be at the groundbreaking, but it has to, we have to have ice cream before.
Yeah, he's holding me accountable for that ice cream. So it would be. So I don't know if there are any other questions. We will definitely come back. We're meeting again next week to kind of work on additional plans. We'll actually be at the site, figuring out where everything is going to be. We're going to invite the woman from LNE to join us to kind of work on that setup. Again, we're very thankful to the high school staff and students. Not only did they design this, they're going to be designing the program and the invitation that will follow. They'll be putting together a little memento for that event as well. So I'm pretty excited that it's really a very collaborative effort with the students and the program and the community. So.
Couldn't be a better person to take in charge of it.
Well, we have a large group of people doing that, but thank you. I think we're on track. So is everyone okay with the date? Was the last, we had to give it enough time after the bids were accepted before we got into the summer and then lost everybody. Yeah, so we thought June 29th might work. We may not have a big bulldozer there, but we'll have a pile of dirt.
Well, you wouldn't have anything there.
So.
The contract is not officially on board until July, but yes, I'm sure they can. If everything falls into place perfectly,
supply a bulldozer.
Just put a bulldozer.
Rid of the bulldozer.
Photo.
The local contract.
Be a good promo for our equipment.
Yeah. Exactly. Was that voted on? I think there was four.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was gonna ask. Is there any issue about using bonded money for a purpose like this? I mean, this would have to come out of bond proceeds, wouldn't it? I was going to suggest that maybe deferring this till the next meeting, because I think the regional school committee on Thursday night could consider whether we could provide the funding for this rather than take it out of what ultimately on proceeds.
So then we would need to rescind the second, rescind the motion.
Well, we can just defer voting on the motion to defer voting. Meeting.
Okay.
We'll just keep the bills.
Are you going to have some postage between?
Do we need to make that in the formal motion to defer the vote and vote on deferring it?
I move that we defer the vote until
second.
The next meeting.
All right, motion second to defer the vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Any opposed? Aye. Thank you.
Julie, when is that communication meeting next week?
We said Tuesday at 5:30 at high school.
Tuesday.
Front lawn.
5:30.
Yeah, well, actually.
Front lawn of the high school.
Front lawn of the high school.
Provided it's not raining.
Right.
Yeah. Okay. If so, umbrella.
All right. Is that it for communications?
That's it.
All right. Moving on. Technology update.
Just a quick update. The Somerset Berkley Regional School District has invited the technology subcommittee of this building committee to participate in the technology assessment proposal that they're moving forward with. The first step of this will be to be included in the consultative review, which will take place this Thursday, May 17th. Here at North Elementary in the mini auditorium. And as this project progresses, I'll be sure to update the building committee as we move forward. And just to reiterate, the technology assessment will help forge a technology plan for the new high school. And I would just like to comment, it does dovetail with an email that Guy Borges had sent around regarding the maintenance plan of the new school and how if there's any way that administration and school district would like the building committee to help in formulating some of these policies where appropriate, I think it might be helpful to both the administration and the school district. But just a brief update, that's what the technology subcommittee is working on.
Okay.
What time does that mean?
We're meeting in front of the
Thursday, 17th.
Yep, we're meeting in front of the office at 7:00. The Somerset, the regional school district has an executive session prior to that. So then we'll be invited in after that.
anything else? Any other business?
I just have one question. Our town meeting is next Monday night, and we'll be addressing the easement issue. I think I had asked at a previous meeting if we could just get an estimate of what the expected savings are of having the easement versus building the retaining wall. I'd like to be able to have that information for the town meeting, because I think that's our primary justification for asking the town to grant that. So just a ballpark number.
Sure.
I just have one question as it relates to the project rep. One of the things that we were thinking of doing is inviting this gentleman to your next building committee meeting so that we could actually meet this person and ask questions of this person specifically. Is that a good idea? Should I do that? We could excuse him if you wanted to discuss things afterwards, but just need to know, that's all. If it's a desire of this committee to actually meet the person, so that we, I mean, what you see on paper and who this person is, obviously, it may be helpful to actually meet him. So I'm just throwing that out there as an idea.
It's a good idea, but we're going to have an abbreviated meeting.
Yeah, no, that's right. It's just really to meet him, and if there's any other follow-up questions of him about his experience and his background, he can answer that. So I'm just asking if that's a desire of the building committee. So we'll have him all here. Okay.
All right. Any other matters?
I just want to let you guys know that those are the binders that Troy had alluded to earlier, 100% submission. One of those, I believe, is a few, and the other ones, I'll just take note. I handed out some of the discs last week. There are also discs in those binders. Those are taken. The hard copies of the drawings specs are in my car or back. I didn't bring them in yet, so I didn't force all you guys to bring them back out to you. Cars like last time, so if you want a hard copy, follow me. I can bring those over to your car.
Okay, very good. Thank you. And Dan and Steve, we have, I think there's an AI3 invoice for you to sign off.
Okay.
Having no other business, I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Yes. You got motion second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.